Well, this evening, I'd like to read for you a section of Scripture, Hebrews chapter 11. And what I want to do is just simply look at an example of how desire for God's kingdom was able to draw out, at least in this case, Abraham and Sarah, to pack up and leave everything they were familiar with, to leave everything that may be considered precious to them, to seek that kingdom, that heavenly city that the Lord had prepared for them. Let me read Hebrews 11, verses 1 through 16. The author to the Hebrews writes, "Now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen, for by it the men of old gained approval. By faith we understand that the worlds were prepared by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things which are visible. By faith Abel offered to God a better sacrifice than Cain, through which he obtained the testimony that he was righteous. God testifying about his gifts, and through faith, though he is dead, he still speaks. By faith, Enoch was taken up so that he would not see death, and he was not found because God took him up. For he obtained the witness that before his being taken up, he was pleasing to God. And without faith, it is impossible to please him, for he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who seek him. By faith, Noah, being warned by God about things not yet seen, in reverence prepared an ark for the salvation of his household, by which he condemned the world and became an heir of the righteousness which is according to faith. By faith, Abraham, when he was called, obeyed by going out to a place which he was to receive for an inheritance, and he went out, not knowing where he was going. By faith, he lived as an alien in the land of promise, as in a foreign land, dwelling in tents with Isaac and Jacob, fellow heirs of the same promise, for he was looking for the city which has foundations, whose architect and builder is God. By faith, even Sarah herself received ability to conceive, even beyond the proper time of life, since she considered him faithful who had promised. Therefore, there was born even of one man, and him as good as dead at that, as many descendants as the stars of heaven in number, and innumerable as the sand which is by the seashore. All these died in faith, without receiving the promises, but having seen them and having welcomed them from a distance, and having confessed that they were strangers and exiles on the earth. For those who say such things make it clear that they are seeking a country of their own. And indeed, if they had been thinking of that country from which they went out, they would have had opportunity to return. But as it is, they desire a better country, that is, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them." May the Lord bless his word to our hearing this evening. Well, this morning, as I've already mentioned, we were reminded of the importance of being reminded of what it is our Lord, through his mercy and his grace in the Lord Jesus Christ, what he calls us to pursue. Now again, as I mentioned this morning, it's all too easy to forget even the things which are most important in life, that have to do with God's glory, which is why we were created, and our happiness, not only here, but in the world to come. It's all too easy for us to forget what it is that will lead to these two things. At least it is for a time. We saw that he wants us to be like his son. That's what he wants us to pursue. This is what he, in his infinite love and his eternal love, actually predestined us for. That's why he sent his only son into the world to live and to die for us, not just so that we would be safe in heaven, although certainly that is the case, but that we would become like him here on earth, that we might do his work here on earth. that we might experience the joy that Jesus experienced in his ministry here on earth before he brings us to where he is in heaven, those eternal joys, which are much greater. We only have a foretaste of them here, but joys that we get to enjoy forever. Peter also reminded us that God has given us the ability to do this, to become like his Son, to do this work, to experience these things through his divine power. And again, we connect that with what it is we've been looking at on Wednesdays with regard to the Holy Spirit. The Spirit is working in us both to will and to do of his good pleasure. But again, we were reminded this morning of the fact that it requires participation from us. It doesn't happen automatically. We must work to put on the Lord Jesus Christ. It requires effort if we are to be like him, that we might serve like him. When Peter was talking about the things that we must with all diligence seek to put on, what he was describing for us really was the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible, the Lord tells us in his word truths and repeats them over and over again, but doesn't do it in exactly the same way. He brings it from differing perspectives so that we get a larger picture of what it is he wants. Peter is simply telling us to put on Jesus, where he writes this in 2 Peter 1, verses 5 through 8. And again, I would just ask you to let these words, which we may not have time to delve into what each of them means, but I think they will strike us in a certain way and that we will certainly understand what he is after. He writes this: "Now for this very reason also," and that is based upon the work the Lord is doing through Christ and preservation, so forth. "Now for this very reason also, applying all diligence," again the idea of striving, "in your faith supply moral excellence, and in your moral excellence, knowledge, and in your knowledge, self-control, and in your self-control, perseverance, and in your perseverance, godliness, and in your godliness, brotherly kindness, and in your brotherly kindness, love. For if these qualities are yours and are increasing, they render you neither useless nor unfruitful in the true knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ." Again, all of these things describe him, and this is why Jesus was useful and why Peter tells us that we should do all that we can to put on these characteristics. He says, if they are yours, then you're saved. They're increasing. They will make you useful and they will make you fruitful, which is what the Lord desires for us. Now again, if we forget that this is our goal, if we become distracted by the world or the things that come into our lives and don't really allow these things to focus our attention on the Lord, we're not going to make the progress we might otherwise make. And so we saw the Lord mercifully appoints reminders. He reminds us in his word. He tells us how we are to use the things that we do in this world actually to focus on him to make progress. How to use our relationships, base them on his word, on his kingdom. How to use our work, do it for his glory. How to use our trials, know that they come from the Lord. They have a purpose, and their purpose is to teach us how we might be more like him, and even how we might use our entertainments, at least the ones we should be doing, to make sure that we're recreating, recreating, getting rest so that we might serve the Lord better. The Lord gives us reminders in his worship through his preaching. That's what we're doing right now. He's reminding us of what he wants us to do through the Lord's Supper that we celebrated this morning, that reminds us of the death of Jesus. And of course, his death means we also die to ourselves in order to follow him. And of course, the Lord's Day, which is a reminder that Jesus rose again from the dead, not only that he might save us, but so that we, having died with him, having been raised again, have been raised to newness of life, to serve him, to live for him in his glory. He's shown us how we might remind ourselves in our day-to-day activities of the kingdom by drawing analogies between what we do and what one day he's going to do. Remember when we go to bed, let's remember when we lay down for the last time. when our lives are over, when we rise up in the morning, that one day we are going to rise when Christ comes again. When we eat, to be reminded of our need of spiritual food as well as physical. When we celebrate those temporal markers, birthdays, and the new year, that we remember that we need to redeem the time that's left to us because it's continually moving forward and it's going to run out. When we see the birth of a new child, remember the new birth. When we see a marriage, remember the marriage, the wedding that we're going to attend someday when the Lord Jesus Christ comes to take us home to his Father's house. And of course, when we attend funerals or pass by cemeteries, again, remember that one day that's going to be our funeral. That's going to be where we're laid to rest in the hope, of course, of the resurrection, our soul being with the Lord in between times. So let the things you see remind you of the kingdom as well as the things the Lord has given to us that focus specifically on that. Now tonight, I want us to conclude the series by considering the single most important thing or factor in our pursuit of the kingdom, and that is how much we really desire it. Now the author to the Hebrews in the text we've just read reminds us that there were those who believed God, who trusted him, had faith in him. And because of that, they did certain things. They were willing to give up certain things. I think it seems to draw the analogy mainly from Abraham and Sarah. Remember how Abraham lived in Ur of the Chaldees. He was in the lineage of Abraham. This is, of course, after the flood. And after the flood, there was the Tower of Babel, and there was the division of the world into different people, groups, and so forth. And a branch from Noah's family, from Shem in particular, Abraham, was in Ur of the Chaldees, and that was his home. That was where he lived. It was a place of paganism, but they kept up the true religion. It was there that the Lord called him to do something similar to what he calls us to do. When he says, I want you to leave your home, I want you to leave your relatives, and I want you to journey to a land which you have never seen. The promised land, the land he was promising to give to Abraham, which was a picture of the true rest of heaven, a picture of the new world that the Lord in his mercy was one day going to create, but yet somehow Abraham knew that it was a picture of a greater reality, and he was willing to leave everything in order to pursue it. Now the reason why Abraham did, the reason why Sarah did, the reason why these others did what they did was because that's what they wanted to do. Again, we always do what it is we want to do. They desired it more than what they had, more than the world. And desiring it, they would not allow anything to stop them from obtaining it. Now I use this quote from Thomas Watson from his book Heaven Taken by Storm, I think earlier in the series, but I think it bears repeating here. He writes this, love puts a man upon the full use of all means to enjoy the thing loved. He that loves the world, how active is he? He will break his peace and sleep for it. He that loves honor, what hazards will he run? He will swim to the throne in blood. Love heaven, and you cannot miss it. Love breaks through all opposition. It takes heaven by storm. Now, the diligence that Peter is speaking of in our text that we saw this morning, and I just quoted for you again, and the striving that our Lord Jesus tells us that we must do to strive to enter into that narrow gate, and the violence that Jesus spoke of, the kingdom of heaven is being preached and it suffers violence. Violent men try to take it by force. Where does all this effort actually come from? Well, it can only come from one place. It can only come from the heart. If we are to put this kind of effort into seeking the kingdom of heaven, if we are to remember it, we must really desire these things if we are ever to gain them. Now, obviously, The Spirit of God has given us that desire if we belong to the Lord Jesus, if we are trusting Him. But as we talked about before, we need to work to build ourselves up in this love, to have the degree of love that is required to do this. The more we love Him, the more we are going to be able to do what He calls us to do. Now, this is one of the reasons, among others, that the Lord actually commands us to love Him to the degree that He does. On one occasion, Jesus was asked by one of the scribes, and the scribes, you know, were the experts in the Jewish law. They were the ones who copied the scriptures, and you know, when you copy a document enough times, you get to know it pretty well. So they were the ones who knew the scriptures. Well, one of these scribes asked Jesus, which was the greatest commandment? And you know what Jesus said. In Mark 12, verses 29 through 30, He says, "The foremost is, 'Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, and you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength.'" Now, on another occasion, Jesus said to those who were following Him, in Luke 14, 26 through 27, "If anyone comes to Me and does not hate his own father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters, yes, and even his own life, he cannot be My disciple. Whoever does not carry his own cross and come after Me cannot be My disciple." And then He says a few verses later, "So then, none of you can be My disciple who does not give up all his own possessions." There is something we must love, and there are things we must not love as much as we love Him. He must be first. Now, we've already seen a couple of reasons why we should love the Lord the most. He loved us first, and He gave His Son to suffer an excruciating death for us, His full wrath on the cross. We should love Him for that sacrifice. We should love Him because of what the Spirit of God has shown us regarding His glory, that He is the most beautiful being, not only that exists, but that could possibly exist. As Anselm said, the greatest conceivable being. The more beautiful something is, the more worthy it is to be loved and desired. But here's another reason why we should love the Lord the most, because if we don't, we will never be able to give Him the devotion that He calls us to give Him, undistracted, full devotion. Jesus tells us in Matthew 6:24, "No one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and wealth." Now, the same thing is true with regard to God and anything else, which is why we must love God, and yet these others, He says, hate them. Hate those closest to you. Hate your own life. Hate your possessions. Be willing to give them all up. Now, you know that Jesus is not saying that we can't or shouldn't love anyone else. You know that He commands us to love. Husbands are to love their wives as they love themselves. Wives are to love their husbands in the same way. Parents are to love their children, and we are to bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. We're all called by Jesus to love our neighbors. We love ourselves. The Lord is not telling us literally to hate them, but again, that our love for Him is to be so much greater for Him than for them, that our love for them is to be like hatred. Now, the same thing applies to things, to our work. You know, we can enjoy our work, but don't get too much into it. Don't lose sight of what's important. Enjoy your recreations, but let them be recreative. Don't let them take hold of your hearts and draw you away from the Lord. We can enjoy the things He's given to us, but don't make idols out of them by loving them too much. We need to make sure God is first in all things. Now, we all know that we're liable to let our hearts drift towards other things. And so this calls us to guard our hearts and to check them every day to make sure that we're not crossing the line in any of these areas. Again, I would remind you of the difference the Lord calls us to. He's not saying love me just a little bit more than these, you know, or be neck and neck. No one can serve two masters. But he's saying that it has to be so much different and so distant that it cannot compete with me. That's what the Lord is saying. We need to make sure that we don't let something else take hold of our hearts and cause our affection and our love towards the Lord to cool. We cannot serve two masters. We must worship the Lord our God and serve Him only. Now, that is key. This, if there was ever a secret, as it were, to godliness and usefulness in the kingdom of God, this is the key. We must love Him most of all. Now, if the Lord is our first love, and if honoring Him is our greatest desire, we will do, as Watson pointed out, we will do what we need to make sure that we do serve Him. We will overcome everything that stands in our way of our becoming like Him and our serving Him. Love breaks through all opposition. Now again, if there's any one thing to remember from this evening, this is it. When you love something, you will do everything in your power. You will break through every barrier. Nothing can stop you if your love is strong enough. Now let me just give you an example. Again, we applied this one time to evangelism. And I think it's important that we actually do that again, because I think the thing that stands in our way is not ability. I don't think it's knowledge that we don't know the gospel. I think it really boils down to desire. You know, what is the best way to reach out to other people? How do we do it? You know, books have been written on this subject. Sermons have been preached on this subject. We need to be equipped to share Christ with others. But I think if we know Jesus, we already have what we need. We have the gospel. We know it, right? If we didn't know it, we wouldn't be saved. So we know what we need to know to be saved ourselves. We know what we need to know to share with other people that they might be saved as well. But knowledge is not the greatest obstacle. It's not a lack of understanding. It's not really even not knowing the best way to do it, you know, the best methods to use. It usually boils down to whether or not we want to do it. And oftentimes we don't want to because it's uncomfortable. Because when we share the gospel with others and we, as it were, reveal to others that we're believers and they didn't know we were believers, maybe they're not going to like us anymore. We might lose friendships. Because when we share the gospel with them, they might end up rejecting the Lord. And if they reject the Lord, they may reject us too. What Jesus said on one occasion is true. If they hated me, they'll hate you as well. So there's a cost involved. Now, how do you overcome that obstacle? Well, the only way is love. Certainly love for the Lord who calls us to do this. Because what we're doing when we share the gospel with somebody else is we are loving them and we're sharing the love of Christ with them. We need to love them too. Love them enough to understand their condition, to know that hell is a very real place and that is where they are headed. And there they will be, well, judged and condemned and will suffer for all eternity. Now, love tells us or dictates that we don't want them to go there. If you care about somebody, you don't want them to have to endure that kind of punishment for all eternity when they might otherwise escape it through the simple message of the gospel. Love is able to break through whatever stands in our way of bringing the gospel to them, because love is willing to risk whatever it must to save those in danger. You know, if a mother's child is in the street in danger of running over, out of love she will go and put her life at risk to save that child. We would do the same for our neighbor. People do that all the time who don't even know the Lord. Love will do what is necessary. Love finds a way to help. Now, again, the love of the unbeliever is different from the love of the believer. We have a greater love We have the love of Christ, the love with which he loved us. Jesus loved those who weren't his, and he reached out to them, and you know he took a lot of abuse. When I say they weren't his, they were actually his people, but in reality they didn't know him because they had not trusted in him. Well, what's true of how love breaks through the opposition to reach out to our neighbor with the gospel is true with regard to everything else that has to do with God, that has to do with his kingdom. If you love him, then you will want to be like him. You will want to be with him. And you'll be willing to do whatever it takes in order to do that. If the path you must take is a path of self-denial, you'll take it. If it means you have to give up people who are close to you, you will give them up. If it means you have to give up your possessions, you will also freely let go of those. If it means you must suffer and work and, you know, experience a great deal of hardship, trials, and temptations, you'll still be willing to take it because that is what you want. That is what you must have. It's the only thing that will satisfy you. When Jesus described the kingdom of heaven to his disciples in Matthew 13 in a series of parables, he was trying to give them different dimensions to the kingdom in a variety of ways, how the kingdom grows, how big it's going to get, what's going to happen at the end of the age, and so forth. But he made a very important point about the kingdom in the two short parables that I had read on another occasion, which you're very familiar with, in Matthew 13, verses 44 through 46. He says, "The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in the field, which a man found and hid again. And from joy over it, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field in order that he might have the treasure in the field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant seeking fine pearls. And upon finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it." Now, what Jesus was telling his disciples through these parables and what he's telling us is that this is what the kingdom must be to us, something that we desire so strongly that we're willing to give up everything in order to have it. And if we are, if we love it that much, if we love him that much, we will have it. So really, I want to close with this question. Is that how strongly that you want it? Is Jesus Christ your treasure hidden in the field? Is he your pearl of great price? Is entering the kingdom your greatest goal? And are you willing to do whatever you must do in order to enter it? Now, if you are, again, this sounds like a great deal of self-denial and self-sacrifice and so forth, and it is at a certain level, but you do need to remember that whatever the Lord calls you to give up, he'll more than make up for it. You won't lose anything of any value in the end, whatever it is he tells you that you must give. But you will gain everything that truly is valuable. And remember as well that he never asks you to give up anything here that he isn't at the same time more than willing to make up in this life, even in this life. Remember what he said to his disciples in Luke 18, verses 29 through 30. "Truly I say to you, there is no one who has left house or wife or brothers or parents or children for the sake of the kingdom of God who will not receive many times as much at this time and in the age to come eternal life." You don't lose, you see. Whatever you give up, the Lord will more than compensate you for it. So the point is, we need to really desire it. We need to be willing to give up whatever we must for it. Now, the love that Jesus gives to us is able to break through all the opposition. And so what we need is love. He's already given it to us, but it needs to be stronger, right? The stronger it is, the more we're going to be able to do what the Lord calls us to do. So what we need again to do, and it really, again, all tends to boil down to this, We really need to seek the Lord. Be in His Word. Be in those reminders. Remind yourself continually. Seek the Lord. Pray. Ask for grace. Ask for strength. Worship the Lord. Be where His Word is being preached, and let it have its work in your life. Remember the Lord and His sacrifice when you come to the Lord's table. Remember He rose again from the dead in order to give you grace and power. And as He is risen from the dead, you are too. And as you're building yourself up in this love, make sure that you don't allow anything to quench it. Remind you of that that scene in Interpreter's House again in Pilgrim's Progress, where the Satan is standing in front of this fire and he's pouring water on the fire, seeking to put it out. But no matter how much water he put on the fire just blazed more and more brightly. And Pilgrim didn't understand, Christian didn't understand what that meant until Interpreter showed him behind the wall. The Lord Jesus was there secretly feeding the fire with oil. He wasn't going to allow it to go out. Well, the Lord isn't going to allow the fire to go out. But still, when we compromise, we can quench it. We need to make sure that we resist flesh and yield to the Spirit as He seeks to cause us to walk in the ways of the Lord. If we do, our love will grow. The kingdom will appear as a treasure to us, as it should, and we'll be willing to give up whatever we must in order to possess it, in order to move forward. So may the Lord help us to grow in this desire and this love for the kingdom of heaven, that we might again advance further in our growth in Christ, and that we might advance the kingdom further. Love breaks through all opposition. Let's bow for a moment of prayer, shall we?